And here's the party freak, Freddy Freaker, dancing new sensation, grabbing the nation, doing the freak call now.
What in the hell was that?
I don't know.
Did he escape from your lab or something?
I'm not that kind of professor.
Ah, okay. Well, coming back, we're going to have a tag team match. Revolution Mexicana taking on the Jersey Boys. In the ring right now is Revolution Mexicana. The one in all black is Miguel Mendoza, and the other is his cousin.
Diego Mendoza.
Thank you. I almost stumbled that one.
Yes, they had a short stink in RCW, and RCW just relaunched again. And they were in that tag team tournament. They didn't make it too far, but, you know, they were in RCW for a little bit.
That's right, and now making their way to the ring are the Jersey Boys, who were brought in by Jake Faircane, the owner of NJWF. The smaller of the two is Trent Dawson, while the other one is Jack Morris.
You can guess by the name that they're probably local talent.
That's right.
Alrighty then.
We know a tiny bit about the Mendozas, but I really know absolutely nothing about the Jersey Boys, so I'm curious to see what their in-ring ability is like.
It should be interesting, and as we start, what we can see, at least this one here, is a little bit technical as he gets out of that grappling hold.
Miguel Mendoza starting it off, the larger and more powerful of the two cousins.
And the one of the Jersey Boys, this one's Jack Morris, right?
I believe so. And if not, we'll be corrected later on.
I don't know, I haven't got corrected on the last one, the Dying Breed.
Yeah, I'm sure Faircane will be sure to correct us on that as well.
Of course he will. All right, back to the action. Miguel Mendoza with a huge headbutt right there, knocking him down.
Ooh, a headbutt from him. That's going to be painful.
I believe that's the intent there, Kenny. Neither team so far has the distinct advantage quite yet, although Jack Moore is trying to distinguish that by throwing Miguel Mendoza.
That's right. Both of them want it. Both of these teams, they want to make a presence.
Ow! Miguel went flying there and crashed on the way down.
Amazing display of strength right there.
Indeed. Now Jack Morris here, gonna pick Miguel Mendoza up, and he hits him with the snake eyes, using the ring as your own weapon.
It always works.
Unless it's against you, then it doesn't.
Exactly.
Miguel firing back with tossing Jack Morris off himself.
Both of these teams seem to be that ever popular combination of speed and strength, so we're gonna see how that unfolds here. Both of these teams, they want to make their presence known here in the tag team division of NJWF.
Indeed, and Jack Morris seems to be going to town on Miguel, hitting a variety of punches and forearm smashes and elbows.
And he continues with the upper hand with an elbow to the neck, across the chest, knocking him down.
Yes. Seems that all these punches and whatnot, Miguel, you know, not quite on his feet, and just as I say that, he lifts Jack Morris up for a suplex.
I think those punches may have just angered him, if anything.
Or may have just woken him up like, hey, start doing stuff.
Exactly.
And there is that stiff clothesline. Jack Morris firing back with a scoop slam.
And now
some more punches onto Miguel's face.
I'm surprised they haven't tagged their partners in quite yet.
Well, maybe they're more intent on, because, like you said, both are speed and power combinations, the power ones are the ones you always want to look out for, because they can do the most damage.
And that's right. And the smaller, more faster ones, And I forgot what I wanted to say there, but you get the idea.
Yes, the smaller and faster ones can hit you with a variety of things, but not as much as, you know, being slammed by one of these bigger guys. And just as you were mentioning that, here's the tag into Diego Mendoza.
Let's see how he can fare out here against Jack Morris. He seems to be, so far.
As he gets him with that pullback elbow, and then he hits him with his other elbow in a kneeling position. And he went flying just as much as his cousin did.
Just as he had momentum, it turned around just like that at the snap of a finger.
And there you see Jack Morris doing that combination of punches and elbows.
And clothesline to the back of the head.
Probably not the best. And he follows it up with actually a technical kind of move, neckbreaker. We haven't seen him do many technical things, so him to just bust out the neckbreaker like that.
Yeah, Miguel Mendoza had a bit of a technical side to him as well, which is surprising.
Mm-hmm. And now Diego is throwing him into the Mendoza corner. It looked like he was going to go for a double team, but Jack Morris said, nuh-uh, and is now lifting Diego up. What's he going to go for here? Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Super fall-away slam.
That was more of a throwaway slam, if anything.
From that height, you don't need much effort to throw a guy over your head.
Nope. And he pretty much showed that right there.
Indeed, yes. And now, it looked like Diego was going for some kind of flip, but Jack Morris caught him and then threw him back for another flip.
It seems Jack Morris has a counter for everything both Mendozas are trying to throw at him.
And this is only one half of the tag team. Can you imagine what the other one does?
I can only imagine, but we are yet to know that until Trent Dawson gets tagged in here.
Quite.
I can't help but wonder, with the Jersey Boys being brought in by Jake Faircane, do you tend to wonder if they were expecting any favors from Faircane?
Well, them being local boys, they should be lucky they even got hired in the first place.
Yeah, I agree there. Jake
Faircane. Even if they did know Jack, Jack's, from what I understand, Jack's more of the kind of the guys like, you earn your spot, I don't give out anything.
That's right, Jake Faircane is a tough one to work for, but when you do right in his good graces, things do tend to go your way.
And as they get back into the ring, Jack, we did shortly see Trent Dawson before he's quickly tagged back into Jack Morris, and now Miguel Mendoza is back in the ring, and for once again, he's the one in control at this point.
And once again, the powerhouses of the two teams are going to go at it.
And Miguel raining in some punches on Jack himself, getting some revenge for all those, you know, kicks and punches he got earlier. Oh!
I wouldn't blame him.
And poke to the eye, kind of stop that. Or
stop,
maybe not.
Hurry. Or not.
Miguel with a bulldog. Looked like Jack was going for another punch, and Miguel just kicked him, stopping that right there.
Yes, he did.
Now Jack Morris throwing Miguel into the Jersey Boys corner and gives Trent Dawson a good shot to the ribs. Whoa! Trent Dawson displaying a little bit of power there.
Hmm. Yeah, yes he is.
I don't like this.
Yeah, they're a little too close to the announce table.
This, you know, this is not RCW. We don't need the table to break on every match. We're lucky it hasn't broken yet this far.
Yeah, so far it's only been the top to it. We've had to rewire the monitors, what, twice now?
Yeah, just about.
Yeah, I shouldn't say we. I was the one who had to rewire. You just sat back and watched.
It was a team effort. I told you what you needed to do.
Uh-huh. A team effort, you say.
Well, at least now they're back, both back into the ring, so don't... So gotta concentrate on the job here.
Exactly. That's right. We have to focus on the task at hand.
And Miguel with another of those big headbutts of his.
Indeed.
Those headbutts have some force if they're able to knock someone right, you know, off their feet.
I can't argue that one. Headbutts are just quite painful, to say the least.
And as you saw earlier, Diego Mendoza got tagged in only to run out of the ring.
I don't really see the strategy in that, but okay.
It's probably because they're in the Mendoza corner, and Miguel can do things like that. Now Diego, he's flying, and he gets him with that springboard hurricanrana.
Nicely done there.
But Trent Dunston, he's trying to get some control there. Diego getting back into control himself, going behind, and he's going to pick Trent up for a back suplex. And now, what is Diego going to do? Tilt-a-whirl backbreaker.
We've seen that move quite a few times here in this show.
Yes, but not quite the way he did it.
No, his was nicely executed.
And then you got Diego there hitting another of those elbows of his. Now what's he going to set up for? Another back suplex.
And Revolution Mexicana is just on a roll here right now.
Speaking of rolls, it looks like he's going to roll right into now two back suplexes. He's going to and a German suplex.
Nice combination there.
Could the trifecta of suplexes be enough? No, only had a one count. But now he's going to throw Trent into the Mendoza corner. What's Diego going to do here? Another backstabber maneuver, the Rocky Mountain Spike.
That's right, shades of Jason Richardson there.
And Trent, wisely, he was that close to the ropes, managed to get himself out of that ring.
Exactly.
But Diego, right behind him, putting him back in the ring and giving him an elbow to the face for his troubles.
Yeah, the Mendoza's, they're certainly trying to keep Trent Dawson from Jack Morris as much as humanly possible.
And that's the smart thing to do. Take on the little guy, and don't let the big guy in. And now it looks like he's got it on his own version of the camel clutch.
You can't help but think that that strategy may be a double-edged sword, though. Not only is it keeping Jack Morris out of the match, but it's also keeping him fresh for when Trent Dawson does, in fact, tag him in.
If. And somehow they are both leaning against that corner. That was kind of weird.
Yeah, it was.
It's just like in that triple threat match. There must be something very enticing in that corner.
It must be. There must be something fascinating in there. I might have to check that out after the show.
With a tilt-a-whirl hurricanrana there, he busted up open Trent Mendoza. Trent Dawson. Crap. Mendoza busted up Trent. There we go.
There you go. Even professors stumble every now and then.
Of course. And now Diego, with that busted up Trent, throws him into the Mendoza corner and gets him with that running elbow into the corner. And Diego with that Tope Atomico maneuver.
I always wondered how that was pronounced.
Well, now you know.
Thank you.
Not quite enough to put Trent away, but you can definitely see him holding his ribs. He is bleeding from the head. Trent, you know, has a huge bullseye on his ribs and head.
Most definitely. He has got to somehow get Jack Morris into this match.
But as long as the Mendozas just keep him away from Jack Morris, it's unlikely.
Well, wait a minute.
He's starting to, he got that arm drag, and here comes Jack. And Diego wisely tagging out to Miguel.
And Miguel, he's got him up, and
Got him in the... Oh, the shell shock maneuver. The referee seems like he's distracted with Diego there. Did not count.
No, he did not. He was trying to get Diego back in his corner.
Now Jack Morris picking up Miguel kicks him and gets him with the flying clothesline.
A big clothesline from the big guy.
And it must have done something, because now you see Jack Morris himself is holding onto his ribs there.
Indeed, both Jersey Boys are hurting.
Hey, so much for that.
Get out and come on, guys, go away.
Stop! We're messing. What? No! No! No!
No! No!
No! No! No! Oh, jeez! No! 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 No!
Don't!
Oh, jeez! Here we go!
Oh! Our announcer's table has just been decimated.
And this is why I bought a Bluetooth headset, so it's not connected to all those wires there.
Yeah, it makes me glad that mine's wireless as well. Thank you for that, Mr. Faircane.
Huge powerbomb through our announcer's table, and you definitely see it. Miguel is feeling the worst for wear, which is why he's tagging in Diego for this double-team maneuver.
Yeah, it looks as though all of them are starting to hurt by now.
Diego's not quite. Diego is the freshest man in this match.
Yeah, but I'm sure he's getting there though. It may not look it, but he's probably wanting to hold his ribs in pain as well.
Possibly. We shall find out as he managed to pick up Jack and powerbomb him.
That is
quite impressive for a man of his size, picking up a man of that size.
Yeah, that is deceptively strong there in part of Diego Mendoza.
And now Jack picks him up. What's he doing here? Looks like a running side slam. Or a power slam, but that was more to the side instead of over the shoulder.
Kind of a trait of Norman Smiley, almost, with that kind of slam.
Almost. And now Diego, well, looks like he was trying to do something there, but Jack pulls him back and gets him with a belly-to-belly suplex.
That's right, he's...
And now Diego hitting another one of those tilt-a-whirl hurricanranas. Now it looks like he's going to go for another one of them power bombs, but no, Jack manages to counter out of that with an arm drag. And now Diego is locking in that single leg Boston crab. And now we know Jack's ribs are hurting. He might tap to this. And no,
and looks as though the referee's lost control of this now.
Manages to get out of it, but now we got Trenton Miguel just battling it out here. And now Diego hitting another one of those back suplexes, and another tilt-a-whirl hurricanrana. Just how many of those is he hit tonight, I have to wonder. He's going to go to the top rope, and it looked like as Miguel was going to grab Jack, he accidentally got Diego in the process. Tripping him up on the top rope.
Bit of a miscommunication there.
And we have our tag into Trent, and Diego might not have seen it because Jack was blocking the way.
Maybe not.
And now, what are the Jersey Boys doing here? Whoa!
No!
Ow! Jack with a huge running knee and following it up with a leg drop.
Devastating knee right there.
You know, Diego, yeah, now Diego, you can tell, is hurting as he tags into Miguel, and Trent gets tagged in himself, and he's getting out of the ring, and look, you already destroyed the table. What more do you want to do over here?
Come on, guys, go away.
Looks like he threw Miguel into the steps. And now it looks like he's picking on those legs that he threw into the steps. Whoa. Miguel throwing Trent onto the corner of those steps.
Ow, that hurts just seeing it.
No kidding, and now all this ringside brawling, and now both the members are back into the ring. Trent Mendoza, his back's got to be screaming in agony. He's got blood pouring down his face. He's going to have to finish this match quickly or mount one hell of a comeback. And just as I say that, super kick busting up to open Miguel Mendoza.
Is that going to be it? No.
He didn't even go for the pinfall. And now Miguel hitting a hurricanrana of his own. Will this be enough? One. No. Miguel kicks out at one. Now Miguel trying to throws him into the Mendoza corner. And tags in to Diego. What are they going to do here? Back elbows from both of them. Now Diego looks like he's calling for something. Another one of those backstabber maneuvers.
Nicely done there.
And Miguel running out and hitting Jack. One, two, three. And that is it.
There you have it. Revolution Mexicana have won it here tonight. Hopefully they've made a statement here for the rest of the tag team division.
Although to be fair, Jersey Boys put up one hell of a fight.
That they did.
Putting them to the, like right here where they put them through our announce table.
Yeah, there's no way that you can count them. You can't sell them short. They did put up a good showing, regardless.
Very much so. But the cousins from Mexico were just too much for the Jersey Boys.
That's right. The Mendozas, they just wanted it that much more.
So, what is next up on this matchup here, Kenny?
What we've got next is our third of our four tournament matches for the NJWF World Championship. And this one I'm looking forward to quite a bit.
And why is that?
I had a reason, but then it left. But anyways.
How can you look forward to something and then forget why?
Because of reasons. But anyways. This tournament match is going to consist of Kenji Matsumoto taking on Nick Hayden.
Do you know anything about this Kenji Matsumoto?
Not really a whole lot, to be honest.
Well, I have here on this card here that he is obviously a Japanese man, if you couldn't tell. And that he likes to specialize in submission and martial arts, but he's not afraid of going high risk if the need is required.
Most definitely. We should expect a lot of devastating kicks from him.
And now, who making his way down to the ring right now? Nick Hayden.
This guy is one of questionable sanity, almost as much as Mark Spears, I would say.
Although on top of his questionable sanity, he's also got the anger issues that we didn't see out of Mark Spears.
Yeah, that's right. And it could be a rather dangerous combination to go up against.
Especially with somebody who is obsessed with all this venom. Because you see, he's got scorpions and spiders all over his trunks and his shirt.
That's right. He nicknames himself Venomous Nick Hayden. He calls his finisher the Strike. So we just may expect that one to take place in this match.
Could very well happen. We've also seen Nick Hayden. He competed for FDW and he won the Hardcore Championship right on the first show.
So it's always impressive to win a championship on your debut.
Yes, especially when it is the first match of the first show.
That's right.
Now Nick Hayden, he's looking to upgrade from the hardcore championship and to promote himself into the world title contendership. And should he win this whole tournament, he very well will walk away the world champion.
That's right, but first he's got to get past Matsumoto here in this first round match.
Which, judging by what we know, will be no easy task.
I don't think it's been an easy test for anyone in this tournament so far.
No, but I believe that's the point. You don't want somebody who's just going to be knocked off in the first round easily. You want every person to be potential winners in this tournament.
That's right. You want all of the competitors to be on their A game.
And we did see right there Kenji busting an armbar. Like we saw, he is a submission kind of guy. But Nick Hayden got out of that armbar pretty quickly.
That's right. He's probably going to want to resort to quite a wide arsenal of submission holds to weaken Nick Hayden down. Excuse me.
Well, it definitely looks like he's going to be focusing on those arms as all of his efforts right now have been concentrated on that arm. And there's some of that martial arts there with that kick to the back.
I'm not going to doubt that Matsumoto is probably going to focus on every limb on Nick Hayden's body.
That was a heck of a German suplex.
Yes, it was. Just caused Hayden to stumble on his feet.
Kenji's definitely focusing on those arms.
He wants to prevent him from being able to use any punches or Irish whips or anything of the sort.
And he tried to go for one of those flying kicks. Nick Hayden just sidestepped him, and Kenji just fell down hard.
Hey, yes, he did. Face planted on the mat. This could be the opening Nick Hayden was needing, and I say that as he gets kicked.
And kicked again. Kicks all over in the faces and the chest, and Kenji's still working on that arm.
Maybe. He's probably wanting to go for another armbar and finish the job right then and there.
The armbar can definitely be a devastating submission hold. Everybody knows this.
That's right.
Matsumoto, oddly enough, looked like he was backing away.
For some reason.
And now Kenji's trying to unload with some of those elbows and kicks. And he gets Nick Hayden with a hip toss there. And it looks like Nick Hayden decides he wants to give Kenji a little of his own medicine by hitting that arm.
It would appear so.
Wow! Nick Hayden gets him with that suplex.
Nicely done, T-Bone suplex.
Now Kenji's still working on that arm. He gotta give it to him. He is not letting up on his focus. He's focusing on that arm.
He certainly is. He's wanting to deprive Nick Hayden of any usage of that arm as much as possible.
Nick Hayden firing with an elbow. And Kenji hits him with a flying wheel kick. And now we get to see another hammerlock put in by Kenji.
He's definitely going to try everything possible to get him to tap out here.
Well, if you focus on that arm enough and you lock on in one of those arm bars again, it's very well possible. And now he's just stomping on that arm. In a very odd predicament for Nick Hayden, I assure you.
Yeah, definitely. I'm sure this wasn't what he was expecting going into this tournament.
Nick Hayden got him with that uppercut, but I don't know if that was a wise idea with Kenji focusing on those arms.
Nah, he may have hurt his arm just as much as he did Matsumoto.
Exactly. Matsumoto just being relentless on focusing on those arms, and now he's locking in the hammerlock again, but I think he's a little too close to the ropes there.
I agree there. He's way too close to the ropes.
Though Nakaden decides to get out of the hold instead of going for the ropes.
By any means necessary. If you can get out of it, go for it.
And Kenji just firmly in control, hitting that belly-to-belly suplex. And as Nakaden just tries to go for something, Matsumoto right there to keep him down with those kicks and the target on the arm.
Yeah, he's certainly preventing Nick Hayden from gaining any bit of momentum.
Now, what's he going to do here? What's he going to do? Michiri driver! Ooh. Kenji with the Michiri driver.
Shades of Takamichi Noku.
That could very well be it. One. No. Only a one count.
Probably going to take a lot more to take down Nick Hayden.
Quite possibly. For a guy with anger issues, we haven't seen a whole lot of that in this match from Nick Hayden.
Which I'm surprised. So you think he would...
Whoa! I saw some of that. With a massive release German suplex.
I mean, Matsumoto just got flung across the ring.
Now Nick Hayden's starting to, you know, maybe getting dropped on his head. Did something in his head, in his brain there. As he starts to get control, Kenji getting out of that grapple.
Yeah.
Nick hitting a neckbreaker there.
Yeah, it just may have rattled something in his head to get him to work right, so to put it.
And it hits another one of those beautiful T-bone suplexes, and bam, Kenji fires right back with a wheel kick.
Yeah.
Now both men going for a test of strength. Nick Hayden wins that, but Kenji manages to reverse that grapple and puts him into that armbar right there.
Is that going to do it?
No, he lets go. I'm not sure why he would let go when he's been focusing on that arm pretty much the entire match.
I don't get why he would let go either, honestly.
Nick Hayden scraping his boot against Kenji's face. And now hits a reverse atomic drop.
Ooh, that's not a pleasant feeling.
Yes, and it's not called the Bunghole Plunger, freaking Montgomery. Now Nick Hayden hits him with that big shoulder block, but not sure if that was a good idea. That is the arm that Kenji has been focusing on.
No, I don't think it's a very wise idea to use the bad arm in this situation. But I really don't think Nick Hayden cares that much.
Probably not. As long as he gets the win, he's probably going to be all right.
I'm sure of that as well.
Wow!
Oh!
With that huge super side slam right there.
Could this be the opening that Nick Hayden needed?
Nick Hayden's locked on the Dragon Sleeper. He's got a submission hold on to Kenji, and Kenji fighting out of it real quick, kneeing Nick into the head. And then Nick fires back with a running STO.
He's certainly trying to mount a comeback here, isn't he?
Kenji looks like he's starting to build towards something here. As he hits, you know, that... Could that combination have been it? No, only one count. And now he's going to throw Nick Hayden into the corner. Looks like he's going to go for a chop, but Nick, stop that. And he's going to use his other... good idea. Uses his other arm to ram his shoulder into Kenji's ribs.
That's right.
I don't think that would be enough to put him down, Nick, but it was a good effort there.
No, it was clearly not enough.
But it apparently did enough damage. Kenji's ribs are hurt. Now Kenji hitting it with the elbow. Oh, Nick caught one of those hits. Got him with a strike.
Oh,
there's the strike.
Out of nowhere.
Just like that. One. Oh, Kenji managing to kick out. And now Kenji lifting him up. He's going to hit him with another one of those Michiri drivers. Could that be it for Nick Hayden? One. Oh, only another one of those one counts.
Boy, these two are just resilient in this match.
And now it definitely seems like both men have jumped into second gears as they're just hitting back and forth with the kicks and elbows from both men.
Now I'm not sure how much Hayden has left in that arm that's been picked away at throughout the match.
Well, we might not know. Kenji's, you know, relentlessly assaulting that arm. And as you saw, Nick Hayden using that elbow to do the ramming. Not sure if that was the best of ideas.
No, I don't think so either.
I mean, we know Isaiah has questionable sanity, but I don't think he lacks common sense.
Your guess is as good as mine with that one.
Oh, Kenji looks like he's going to go for small package one. Oh, Kenji trying to surprise Nick Hayden there.
Yeah, but to no avail on that exchange.
Both men just having a bit of a stare down there. Both men just hurt. Both men relentless. Nick Hayden with a beautiful Northern Light suplex, and that didn't even look like he got a one count. Kenji just rolled right out of that.
Yeah, I don't think that was even a one at all.
Nick Hayden going for yet another cover, and another one count.
It's taken quite a bit for both. I'm sure both parts are wondering, what do I have to do to keep them down for three?
Indeed, because they're having a hard enough time keeping them down for one.
That's right.
Well, Nick Hayden with a beautiful suplex, German suplex, with a pin, but Kenji again just rolling out of it. And again, Nick Hayden just out of nowhere with the strike. And somehow, Kenji is busted open. He is bleeding, and now he picks up Kenji and for a forward fireman's carry slam. And now he's locked on that camel clutch. Kenji, he's trying to turn himself around. Decides he's now going to get to the ropes and gets out of the submission hold.
Yeah, it manages to power out of it.
Going for one of those springboard high-flying maneuvers. Springboard dropkick. That could be all the opening he needs. And now he's starting to hit that leg. Not sure why he'd want to do that.
I'm not sure either, honestly.
When you've been focusing on the arm the entire match, you should stay with it. Don't try to go for one of the other appendages.
Exactly, but I'm sure there's a method to his madness.
Nick Hayden just trying to get himself a breather here. Just trying to keep himself away from Kenji.
And he's failing at that.
Because Kenji just right on it. And Kenji's picking him up for a third Michiri driver. A third Michiri driver.
The third time could be the charm here.
One, two, three, and
it is. Kenji Matsumoto moves on in the NJWF tournament.
Now that was one hell of a battle from both men.
Indeed it was. It was an intense fight from bell to bell. Both of them were giving it their all.
But both men were hurting. Only one of them was bleeding, but you have to imagine if it went any farther that maybe both of them would have been just bleeding all over the place.
I wouldn't put it past them.
You got three Michiri drivers, you got two the strikes, and it, I guess working on that arm paid off, that so Nick Hayden wouldn't be able to use that arm to kick out.
Indeed. So Matsumoto joining Mark Spears and...
Mark Spears and...
And Lucas McAfee.
McAfee.
Thank you.
Wait, what's Nick Hayden doing here? What? Nick Hayden apparently not happy about what happened here.
That was just being a sore loser on his part.
I mean, you should be proud you had that good of a match as you did, and then, you know, just to hit a third strike on the guy after he won, when his guard was down.
Yeah, that's just being a sore loser.
Alright, let's get ourselves ready for this next match, and it looks like a tag team match.
That's right, we've got tag team action here once again. This time we have TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze taking on the Towers of Pain. Making his way out right now is TJ Justice, who grew up idolizing the original ECW, and who models his style after the old ECW.
So this guy's pretty hardcore, huh?
That's right.
Staying a little too close to those fireworks for my taste, but, you know, tweets his own.
Yeah, he was. And his partner here for tonight is Crimson Blaze, who had a very brief stint in RCW, but was soon released after two or three matches.
Crimson Blaze seems to be one of those guys who pops up every now and then here and there, and then just as quickly leaves.
I wouldn't really doubt that. I saw him for a split second, and I turned around, and I turned back, and he was gone.
Exactly. And I'm not sure about his whole rising through the flame, and what do you have to imagine? What's in that gauntlet there of his?
That chalice, I'm not so sure.
Well, he's taking a drink from it. That red mist. It's like, why would you spit that out? That can't be sanitary.
Probably not. But whatever floats one's boat, I suppose.
I guess so. And now, who will be making their way down the ring? The Towers of Pain. And look at the size of these guys.
Some of you may be familiar with these two. The one on the right is former OFW World Champion Sid, and the other is his brother Zeke, who used to go by the name of Zoltar in RCW.
Yeah, and they're brothers. And can you imagine being the mama of these two boys? You have to imagine that these two alone ate their parents out of house and home.
I can imagine so. They're...
I mean, their food intake alone.
I just know I wouldn't want either of these two mad at me.
I have to imagine these two walking into an all-you-can-eat buffet, and as soon as they saw those guys walk through the door, they shut the thing to saying closed.
I would certainly hate to be TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze right now for having to face these two titans.
I don't know, TJ Justice seems to be handling himself pretty well right now.
Yeah, it appears so.
It's like Sid hasn't had a moment to get anything done right yet, as he gets thrown into that barricade corner. And TJ Justice is laying some punches into Sid.
Justice is doing the smart thing, attacking often and frequently.
Well, and now he's got Crimson Blaze helping him out by throwing him into those stairs repeatedly, time after time, weakening those like knees and ankles of Sid. Oh!
Ooh.
Now he just got thrown through those steps.
This could be the very strategy that they need, is to just beat up on one at a time, on one of these two monsters, and just try to leave the other one neutralized in the corner.
Was trying to do a comeback there. Oh! Threw TJ Justice right up into the air.
just flung him in the air.
That could be what Sid needs, and just as I say that, TJ Justice throws him back into the corner, and here we go, tagging into Crimson Blaze. With a drop toe hold and elbow drop combination.
I'm actually surprised, because I was anticipating Towers of Pain to just steamroll over these two.
Yeah, just lay waste of these two. And now, Yeah, that might just happen right now. As Crimson Blaze is in the Tower Pain corner, and he gets himself out of there real quick.
And rightfully so.
Yeah, I would not want to be in the Tower of Pain's corner.
Neither would I.
Now, Crimson Blaze looks like he hits a Twist of Fate-like maneuver. And Sid is like, no, it's not enough to keep Sid down. And whoa!
Whoa.
We've seen a lot of deceptively strong moments here tonight, haven't we?
Yes, we have. This happens to be no different.
I don't think I've ever seen Sid get thrown around quite like that.
I don't think I've ever seen him get thrown around, period.
And now Crimson Blade is locking in that Anaconda Vice, and Sid just kneeing him in the back of the head, getting himself out of there.
What's
that? Looks like they're going for a test of strength. Oh dear. Crimson Blade being picked up and thrown down.
The amateur mat wrestling takedown there by Sid.
And he gets thrown into the Towers of Pain corner hard and gets running.
Threw him hard.
And gets a running punch into his kidneys.
Yeah, followed by a huge headbutt there by Sid.
Now Sid lifting Crimson Blaze up and throwing him down with that scoop slam. This may be the Towers of Pain starting to get their momentum going.
It just might be, and I'm not so sure they're
going. Oh dear. Sid with that backbreaker there.
Yeah, it looks as though the Towers of Pain are not going to stop their momentum anytime soon.
Now, Sid with a series of knees into Crimson Blaze's chest area there. And now he's got him locked into the... Not quite sure what you would call that, but he just wrenched him around and threw him down.
Yeah, just wrenching on the shoulders there.
Looks like Crimson was going to go for something, but then Sid hit him with the STO and now has him locked into that camel clutch. But again, he's too close to the ropes.
Far too close to the ropes.
I don't care how big of a guy you are. If all they have to do is reach their arm out and grab the ropes, I highly don't think he's going to tap right there, Sid.
Yeah, it would have been smarter if he would have just dragged them a little bit farther away from the corner.
Crimson Blaze looks like he's had enough, and he's tagging into TJ Justice here. TJ hitting him with a one punch, two punch, three punch. And so, oh, geez.
Oh.
I'm pretty sure Sid is not expecting what he's been getting from TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze.
Mostly from TJ Justice, it seems.
TJ Justice just throwing Sid around. Now, see, TJ Justice probably could have had that submission held fine, but Sid's and his long legs were just right there next to the ropes.
Indeed. He just had to hook his right foot under that rope.
And now we get to see our first look at what Zoltar has been up to for these last time we saw him.
Yes, we're going to see if Zeke's got a bit of ring rust to him since RCW.
Throwing TJ and TJ throwing Zeke around. TJ Justice just throwing both these big giant men around.
Again, deceptively powerful.
And then he gets Zeke there with that spine buster. Zeke looks like Zeke's trying to get something going, but TJ Justice just not letting him go.
Absolutely not, and that's pretty much the strategy against a pair of giants.
It's bad enough dealing with one, then you have to deal with two. TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze have been doing pretty well so far dealing with these two.
Indeed.
And now, Zoltar... No, I gotta get used to calling him by Zeke. I'm so used to calling him Zoltar.
Yeah, I've had my moments of coming close to calling him Zoltar as well.
Alright, TJ Justice is getting with a neckbreaker, and he's following that up with that showman-like elbow drop.
Yeah, I'm not sure what those moves were before the elbow, but... doesn't seem to affect Zeke all that much.
Oh, Zeke steamrolling right into TJ Justice there with that shoulder block.
Yeah, it must be like getting hit by a bus. Vicious headbutt there by Zeke.
Now Zeke's going to throw TJ Justice in against the ropes. Big power slam by Zeke.
Now, power slam by him, that's... that I'm sure that hurts even more than by any other wrestler.
Now he's going to pick up Zeke, and he gets him with that backbreaker there.
I'm not sure if that's a very wise thing to do to a guy who's a whole person larger than you. I can imagine all that weight coming down on your knees got to hurt your leg.
Wait, Zeke's locking on the Rings of Saturn there.
Yeah, yes, he does. He's got the Rings of Saturn there on TJ Justice.
And TJ Justice wisely getting out of there as fast as he can. And then he gets hit with another one of those steamrolling shoulder blocks.
Yeah.
And now he's got those huge fists just raining down on him.
God, that must be like getting hit by a brick.
Bricks, buses, steamrollings. Just a whole... It's unpleasant, let's put it that way, to go against these guys.
Yeah, it's like going up against everything big and heavy. Which it is in this case.
And now TJ Justice is tagging himself back into Crimson Blaze. Hitting that toe-hold, elbow-drop combination again.
I tell you, TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze, they seem to be working pretty well together.
Yeah, it's very efficient for being the first time teaming up against... and against these two giants, no less.
Indeed. Crimson Blaze, he is just... putting it on full throttle here against Zeke.
And just as we mentioned that, Zeke hits him with that shin breaker, trying to keep that smaller, faster man down.
That's right, you want to keep him as grounded as possible.
Now he's going to throw Crimson Blaze outside the ring the hard way. You saw Crimson Blaze just go right over that top rope.
And both towers of pain going after him now.
Ah, jeez, here we go again.
Oh, come on, guys.
No. Okay, yeah, go past the corner, but, you know, go past the table. Just don't be anywhere near us. We just had this darn thing rebuilt.
Yeah, go that way, please.
No, I guess they hurt us. Crimson Blaze now with that clothesline to the back of Zeke's head. And now he's kicking him in his face repeatedly. And now Crimson Blaze with his own showman-like elbow drop, but he got some air on that one.
Yeah, yes, he did.
Now Zeke, big headbutt to the back of Crimson Blaze's head. And now, oh dear, what's he going to do here? Ah!
Oh!
Zeke with a massive powerbomb there. Crimson Blaze doesn't look like he's letting it affect him, and he hits that huge Winds of Change, Black Hole Slam, whatever you want to call it, maneuver. And now, whoa, man, those ropes are powerful to be able to hold up that big frame of Zeke like it did there.
No kidding.
And now... TJ Justice and Crimson look like they're going to try to do what they did with Zeke earlier. Team up on him on the outside there. TJ with that boot to the face.
Yeah, they have to resort to strategies such as this.
And TJ just got shoved off the ring by Zeke. And now Crimson Blaze gets thrown into the corner, but that gives TJ Justice the distraction to throw Zeke into that ring corner there. And Crimson busts his head onto that ring corner there. Zeke seems like he's had enough. He's tagging into Sid.
I wouldn't blame him, because TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze did not give him one bit of time to regroup.
Not at all. And now Sid Got Crimson Blaze. What's he going to do here? He's going to throw... Well, looks like he was going to throw him out of the ring, but Crimson stopped him and got him with a jawbreaker.
Nice counter there.
Now he's going to throw Sid out onto the apron, and he kicks him down, and now he's at the arena floor. Yeah, oh, dear.
Yeah,
no,
this seems...
I don't like...
Seems to be the primary plan to keep... to keep picking away at the at these two giants outside of the ring, and hope to God the other one doesn't follow suit.
Yeah, really. It was a little off camera there, but Zeke just threw TJ Justice into the ring. just to probably get him out of his way.
Probably so.
Now, again, Crimson tried to do something there, but Sid got wise to his act. But Crimson Blaze, persistent, trying to do it again.
Indeed.
Not quite sure what Crimson Blaze has in mind, but... Ooh! Threw him into those steps and just tripping over him.
Oh, his...
And now, Sid gave him a little of his own medicine there.
Yes, he did right there.
Now, all four members in this match, in that corner... But the only ones who are actually doing anything are Blaze and Sid.
Both the legal men in this match.
Now TJ Justice is throwing Sid into the corner. Just a whole bunch of throwing around, it looks like.
It would appear so. They better keep...
Trying to use the ring and the barricade as the weapons themselves. Just throw them into those, throw them into the steps, throw them into the steel post there.
They are just pulling out all the stops here for this tag match.
Not quite sure what happened there. Zeke, I guess, threw TJ Justice back into the ring, and TJ Justice right back out.
Yeah.
Now, Crimson Blaze hitting Sid's skull against that ring apron again. And now they're getting back into the ring.
Let's hope they stay in the ring this time.
Now, Crimson Blaze looks like he's trying to go for a small package here. One. Oh, only got the one count. And now Crimson Blaze throwing him into the Justice Blaze corner. Picks him up. Impressive, putting him out of the top rope.
I'll say.
Sid elbows him. And Sid comes off with a huge, huge diving spear.
Wow. Can you imagine seeing a 7-footer jump off the top rope and just tackling you in midair?
It's a horrifying thought.
I would probably die from a heart attack just from the sight of that.
Oh, and so much for, you know, staying in the ring.
Yeah.
Now Zeke threw Crimson Blaze into those steps, making him trip over those. Looks like Sid wanted to go for something there, but Zeke stopped him, and now Sid threw him into those steps. No, go back to the other corner. I don't like it when you all are this close.
Yeah, go over there, please.
Ah, that's better, you know, sorta. Got Sid in the ring. Crimson Blaze is right out in front of us. Oh, jeez, now they're all brawling right here.
I don't even remember who the legal man is, do you?
Crimson Blaze and Sid.
Ah, thank you.
If the referee's got, you know, he's got to know who the legal men are. So just in case he forgets, I can remind him.
That's why you're here.
And Crimson Blaze just getting thrown around into the barricade, into the apron again.
I'm starting to wonder if TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze are going to have any fuel left in this...
Well, when you got these two big behemoth men just literally throwing you around, it's hard to wonder if they can or not. And Crimson Blaze again being thrown into that barricade.
And just to point out, I'm sure those stairs have been beaten up just as much as these four have in this.
TJ Justice trying to throw Zeke back into the ring. Zeke just gets back out. Crimson Blaze gets into the ring. Crimson Blaze gets out. Zeke, pick a spot and go with it. This is not Ring Around the Rosie.
And I don't think this is a tornado tag either.
No, it's not.
Because I'm quite positive that it has to end in the ring.
Crimson Blaze just standing outside that ring. And Zeke getting out. He's going after Crimson, but TJ Justice right there to put him back into the ring. Okay, now they're both back in the ring. Oh, it looks like all the beatings they took. TJ Justice coming in like a house of fire.
Uh-oh.
Knocked on Zeke. Knocked on Sid. Punches Zeke. Zeke, what's he gonna do here? TJ Justice getting out of that. And now it's the Towers of Pain's turn. Boom. Down goes TJ Justice. Bam. Off goes Crimson. And a huge overhead hit. Oh, what's Sid going to do here? Oh, handle slam.
With authority.
And now, wait, what are you doing, Sid? What are you doing?
I don't know what that was all about, but okay.
I would think after you hit such a massive move, you'd try to go for the win, but I guess not. Now he gives TJ the opportunity to do things like this.
I'm going to guess it's a bit of ring rust in part of the Towers of Pain.
Yeah, that could come back to cost them, as TJ went for the win there, but he only got a count of one.
Yes, he did.
Now a kick to the head, double axe handle to the back, and a clothesline to the back of the head from Zeke.
Yeah, I'm sure that combination's probably amplified by 10 being when it's being done by Zeke.
With those just meaty hands and those big old forearms, and TJ Justice throwing Zeke out of the ring.
Now I don't think Zeke appreciates it that much now.
No, especially when you got Sid right there watching. Now he's just choking TJ Justice. Towers of Pain definitely have to be frustrated by now.
I wouldn't blame them one bit. I would imagine they thought that this would be a 2-minute work for them.
Considering this is the first time TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze have ever teamed, it's not too surprising that they thought that. But these two guys just been giving them everything they could get, need more.
You know, a moment ago, it appeared Zeke was going to go after Blaze, but Crimson Blaze wisely pulled down that rope, making Zeke spill out of the ring.
Crimson Blaze definitely has some good ring awareness on him.
That he does.
Now, can we get both legal guys back into the ring, please?
Yes.
TJ Justice kicking Zeke from the ring apron. Now he follows that up with a big clothesline there.
Managing to get the big guy down there. And
look
at the strength!
Oh my gosh! Picks him up and hits that Widowmaker move.
His back is probably crying for mercy from that. Because Zeke is
obviously
not exactly a lightweight.
You saw TJ Justice was holding his... Oh, jeez.
Oh, what's going to happen here?
Two giant elbows.
And yet Justice manages to get up like it was nothing.
Sid, what are you doing? You know what? Why do we even put wires on this thing anymore? Why even bother? Like, we shouldn't even bother setting up tables if people are just going to randomly come over and tear our table apart. Because they're like that.
You're going to rewire the monitors next.
Fuck, I'm not going to even put up the table. Just leave it the way it is.
I wouldn't blame you, because all we really need are just these chairs and these wireless headsets.
Ow!
Whoa.
Zeke, I think our table's got a face print on it.
It may be. It almost looks like he left an indentation on it.
Sid trying to go for that win, but TJ Dust is, you know, only get... Oh!
Oh!
TJ Dust has punched him so hard and knocked him out of the ring.
I've lost count of how many times that these two teams ended up out of the ring. But at least this time they're getting back in it. Or not.
Nope, no they're not. They're just brawling at ringside.
Oh!
And now Sid getting thrown back into the ring. TJ, there we go. Now they're both back into the ring. There we go.
Now can it
end? Sid with an STO. Now he's going to tag into Zoltar. Zeke. Yes, Zeke. Now, what's TJ just... he blocked a kick and talked some trash. Not sure if at this point in the game it's that good of an idea to talk trash.
Especially no.
When you have these two enraged giants. Oh!
Oh!
Ow! Ow, that 1, 2, 3.
That certainly clinched it for the Towers of Pain here in this match.
Yeah, that spear clothesline combo just TJ Justice could not get up from that.
No, he could not.
Especially after doing things like this and picking up these big men, your back and your ribs are screaming in pain, and it was only a matter of time.
I will say, though, TJ Justice and Crimson Blaze, despite having teamed up for the first time, they did remarkably well. They worked remarkably well, as you said. They gave the Towers of Pain a run for their money up until there.
right up into that final moment.
That's right. The Towers of Pain, Sid and Zeke, prevail here tonight. They're definitely going to be one to look out for in the tag team division.
Yes, precisely. And now we will be moving on to our main event of the night.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen. It is the fourth and final World Championship Tournament match of the first round. Which is Hades taking on Jeremy Walker.
Now Hades here, he loves those spikes of his.
That's right. This one he's riding down to the ring. He built himself. Built every part of that motorcycle himself. He's not afraid to display that.
He's in another promotion. Hades managed to become the world champion, and he was the tag team partner of Osiris.
That's right. So Hades is a bit well known out there in the call community. And he's wanting to make a staple for himself here in NJWF and hopefully prevail in the world title tournament.
He also had a short stint in OFW, if I remember correctly. Am I right there, Kenny?
That's right. He was momentarily part of the OFW Heat branch.
So not quite like this. He was going under a different persona at the time.
That's right.
Speaking of different personas, we have Jeremy Walker coming down to the ring, who used to be Crimson in RCW.
And that's right. He had a good run in RCW, had multiple hardcore championships, an amazing feud that was with Chaser. And he was a former tag team champion with Osiris.
Both these men former tag team champions with Osiris.
Yeah, despite what you think of Osiris, he seems to click pretty well with whoever's tagged with him.
Well, when you think about it, you got somebody with the power and size of Osiris. You put him with anybody, I can imagine he can at least coexist with people.
Or at least try to.
Yes, at least the attempt is there.
Yes, Jeremy Walker, he's been in and out of call wrestling. He's tried his hand at the underground indie leagues. Didn't get too far there up until he finally got the call from Jake Faircane to join NJWF. We're going to see if him or Hades will make it here in the tournament in advance.
Well, as soon as that bell rings... There we go, and now we are off. And as you can see, as soon as these two walk up to each other, Hades has a distinct size advantage.
Oh, clearly a size advantage and power.
Jeremy tried to throw him into the corner and do something, but Hades just reversed that and punched him. And now Hades going to go for as soon as I say that, Jeremy gets in control.
That's right, hit Hades with that uppercut there.
And Jeremy Walker there with an uppercut of his own. Now they're getting in a test of strength. Neither man winning that one, which is surprising. You'd think Hades would win a test of strength between these two.
Yeah, you would think, but Jeremy Walker, he's got a bit of a technically sound side to him.
Throwing Hades into that corner. Now it looks like he's going to rain down some punches onto Hades. Whoa!
But Hades ends up saying differently.
Only gets two in before he decides otherwise. And now Hades looks like he's dragging him into the corner.
What's going to happen here? Wow.
On the ropes.
That was a good display of balance there.
And just having that fist rain down onto formerly Crimson, Jeremy Walker.
That's right. A huge spine buster. A one-handed spine buster, it looked like.
Just picked him up and slammed him right down onto his spine.
That's right. And just as I thought he was going to be in control, Walker counters with a belly-to-belly.
Mm-hmm. And now, whoa! Hades with a jumping, flying clothesline.
That was a pretty athletic move there by a big guy.
Very much so, and Jeremy trying to keep Hades down there by throwing him around and hitting those uppercuts. Hades just not staying down.
No, he is not. Neither one of these two want to go down in the first round of a world championship tournament.
And Jeremy, as you saw, trying to hit the chop block, and now he's trying to throw Hades into that corner again. Punches him, Hades just firing out of that corner with that jumping clothesline.
Like a bat out of hell.
Hades proficient in his striking. As you can see, he very precise on his punches.
Yes, he is. He is quite the pure striker kind of fighter.
And now Jeremy trying to get something going here. Throwing Hades. Nope. Hold him back for that power slam. Now picks him up again for that backbreaker onto his knee.
And neither one of these two are slouches, not in any stretch of the imagination.
And Jeremy again with another one of those power slams. Using the momentum of throwing Hades to his advantage.
He's got it.
Oh, jeez. Hades just suplexed, Jeremy Walker.
That he did. That may have just stopped the momentum that Walker was gaining. Hades is trying to get the upper hand here.
Yeah. Speaking of upper hands, gets him with that uppercut.
That's right. Those uppercuts are pretty effective.
Now he's just raining in those punches, and as you can see, he's continuously going for those jumping clotheslines, and Jeremy having none of it and just hitting him with those punches, with those Luthes, presses.
That's right. He's going to have to resort to any means possible to take this big guy down.
And hold this big guy down, which he did not do when he had him in that game of clutch there.
No, he did not.
Although he's picking Hades up, well, I'm impressed he picked him up with ease.
Yeah, that's quite a good display of strength there in part of Jeremy Walker.
Both men just going for some punches there. Hades with a neckbreaker. Wasn't quite sure what he was going for until right at that moment.
That's right, Hades is trying to keep Walker down.
Hits that big back right, but Jeremy Walker fires back with those break to the eyes. And now, pretty technical maneuver, you know. Hades putting him into that armbar, but too close to the ropes.
Much too close to the ropes. But Hades did not let up as he hits a back slam. Sorry.
Back suplex. There you go.
Thank you.
Now, what's Crimson Ending going to try to do here? No, not Crimson. Jeremy Walker. I'm used to calling them by their former names.
It happens.
Ooh, Jeremy Walker got him with that chop block.
This may have been Walker's strategy here, leading Hades out to this 2-inch padding.
Yeah, maybe inflict some more damage there. Now he gets him with another one of those Luthes presses. But Hades looks like, whoa! That plan kind of looked like it backfired there.
Yeah, it certainly looked like it went awry
for Jeremy Walker.
Right.
And now it looks like he's at least going to try that again. Clotheslines Hades down, and now hits him with that diving knee drop.
Yeah,
super kick.
Oh,
He calls that the one shot, one kill.
That's right.
I think it might take a few more one shots.
It just might.
Because Hades just looked like he took that super kick and just shrugged it off like it was nothing.
he took that as if Walker just flicked him.
Now Hades is starting to build some momentum there, hitting that Russian leg sweep in Hades. No.
No.
And Hades. No.
Come on.
No. We've already had this table destroyed. Oh, well, what the hell? It's the main event. Who cares?
Who cares at this point?
Yeah, at this point, it doesn't matter. They're just going to take the pieces anyways and use it for the next show, so what the hell?
Yeah, thanks to Insta-Table.
Instant Table, that's definitely one of our greatest sponsors here.
That's right.
Alright, do whatever, Hayes. What are you going to do? Oh, gee.
Oh, boy.
Looks like he's going to hit him with that powerbomb, that last ride powerbomb.
He calls it Road Rage.
Road Rage!
Road Rage into the announcer's table.
He could have very well won by countout. It doesn't look like Jeremy's going to wake up anytime soon.
I'm not so sure Hades wants to exactly win that way.
Or maybe he does. It looks like he's just getting back in the ring. He looks like he's conflicted. Does he want to? Does he not? Does he want to? Does he not?
He does seem conflicted with it, doesn't he? I mean, it looks as though the referee can count to 1,000. I mean, Walker is just laid out.
Yes, Walker is... You can see the stars rotating around his head. Look like Hades came to a decision. He'll take the count out and win.
It would appear so.
Yes, Walker has not moved an inch or a centimeter. He has not moved, period.
Looks like he's trying to tell looks like the Hades is trying to tell the referee to count faster.
Nah, he could have counted it slower for all he cared. Jeremy Walker was out.
Yeah, he's not getting up.
So Hades will progress to the next part of the tournament under scrupulous circumstances, though.
Yeah, regardless, he moves on to the semifinal in the tournament. I don't know
just
about
look
you.
Look at that road rage again, just through that table.
And that was just it for Jeremy Walker.
Jeremy was finished, kaput. He was out.
Yeah, that he was.
And now he realizes he just lost.
And I'm sure he's gonna be furious about it.
Oh, I have no doubt about it. Anyway, that is all the time we've had. Thank you for watching the first episode of NJWF Turnpike, and we will see you next time.
For the Professor, I'm Kenny Durst. We'll see you next time.